Hey, it's time for the Bizarre Briefing for November 2015. I'm Bryce Castillo.
That's the month. Hey, I'm Brandt Hughes.
You're Brandt Hughes.
Yep.
The two of us are the editors, take two.
Yeah.
Editors, shooters, producers of Scam School and
Remix.
Remix. Yep. The remix. We do the ads.
All the second channel content.
All of the second channel stuff. You've seen Brandt a lot in the ads.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. Ideally, yeah, you would have.
I mean, yeah,
maybe. And I also do ads and am in them occasionally. You see a lot of my voice. You get a lot.
Right.
I do a lot of the voice stuff with Brian because we do a lot of the. You know, like we just did the one this month for Scam Gumbo.
Yes.
Which was a behind-the-scenes look at shooting a Scam School ad, but was actually an... that was an ad.
What?
Yeah.
What?
Though it is kind of
funny. It's all fake.
We spend 70% of that ad saying the wrong promo code. Intentionally, of course, but...
Classic.
Yeah. So that's where you know us from. Also, if you know Brian's podcast and stuff, I... produce a lot of those shows. Brandt has been Brian's assistant for a long time before
like 3 years now.
Yeah, man, it's been getting up there. And we've talked a lot about these before in older episodes of the Bizarre Briefing. So if you go back to the old episodes,
got a whole bounty of them.
A whole bounty of how we started working with Brian.
John, who's usually here.
Yep, John.
He handles scam stuff all the time.
Yes, all the time. Like all
every
of his,
day. Like just about.
And almost everything is scam stuff. Like I'll call him and he'll say, "Hello, John, scam stuff here." And I think, John, that's not your last name is not scam stuff.
Yeah, you think you would know that
Tilton.
By now?
It's Tilton. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
All
crazy,
the time.
Crazy upbringing, I guess.
Guy. Yeah.
So this is the show where we talk about sort of the behind the scenes look of what's going on here at Bizarre Magic and just around our lives.
What's the high lowdown?
Yeah.
That's what the kids are saying.
Give me hot LD.
Brandt and Bryce, what's the hot lowdown? Well, we're going to tell you.
Every day. Hey, I need the hot lowdown.
We need the hot lowdown.
But never a download. Do not ever give me a download.
Gross.
Yeah. Never. It's November. We were coming to the end of the month, and I realized, wow, we had a lot of big stuff happen.
Yeah.
In the past month or so.
Yeah.
Probably the most notable has been the Arcana Tavern. No, God, I always get this name wrong. I always type out Arcana Tavern, and it's not it at all. It's the Rogues Tavern.
It's the next in the Rogues lineup, the Rogues collection.
The Arcana's Rogue, right.
Yes.
The Rogues Tavern, which is basically an evolution of the Scam Pack, but also it includes the pint glasses and the shot glasses and a whole bar kit, which is a good thing, I would say. If you asked me,
I'm glad you
would open.
I'm glad you feel that way, yeah. Bryce.
I know that there are some haters on there that I think are wrong. It's actually when you open it up, it's a good thing. You own those items now, you know. But you can do a ton of tricks.
Way better than like video games where you're just licensing out the rights to play the game.
You know, you actually don't own anything. You're just buying a copy of the rights to play. You know. This you own. That friction pen, you can write your name on it.
We can't take that back.
No.
We can try. Not easily.
Come and take it.
Yeah.
And it's got a dossier full of stuff that you can do with the Scam Pack stuff. It's got both of the Scam School books, so you can do like everything. Like you can really do pretty much everything with
it. Yeah. I mean, it's very similar to, you know, how the what was the thing before it?
The Scam Pack?
Scam Pack. I was going to say something kind of like that, and then I was like, that's not right. And Scam Pack. It's like the Scam Pack, where the Scam Pack was like, hey, here's a little package where you can do a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah. And it's hard to find stuff, right? Like,
sure, yeah.
Specific types of dairy creamer, specific types of straws, matchbooks, matchboxes, chain link, chain ball, chain
chain link chain ball chain.
Yeah, the chain link chain. Yeah.
I mean, good luck searching for that.
But it's stuff that would be weird to find out, find on its own, or to like buy one of.
Or you like you might find something similar, but maybe it doesn't like do exactly what you want.
Yeah. You don't got to worry about any of that.
Yeah, and like everything in the Rogue's Tavern is, I think, like way nicer than the Scam Pack was. You know, Scam Pack was fine. You know, it was cool. Like it was versatile, which is what it really banked off of. But you know, there weren't a lot of like super nice high quality items. I think. I mean, it was fine.
Sure.
But the Rogue's Tavern, like, there's some genuinely nice stuff in there.
Yeah, I think not only like the pint glass, the original design has gotten updated a little bit. And then you get the other three new designs, which are all really fantastic. We can see them here on screen.
I'm really glad we found a use for that updated regular logo.
Yeah.
I put in some hours into that because originally that was going to be on a challenge coin, which obviously ended up changing into what the challenge coin is now.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I like John was like, "Hey, we need like this updated for the challenge coin," and so like I put a bunch of work into like you know hand recreating like the BB logo with all these things, and then they were like, "Yeah, we're just not gonna do anything with that," and that was like a year and a half ago, and then all of a sudden like they're working on this, and it's like, "Oh yeah, we found a use for it. It's great.
Yeah. It's kind of funny, like. In fact, one of the before I was hired by Brian, one of the first things that they had asked me, or no, this was later. But I remember we spent a lot of time working on some glyphs and things for a potential Rogues item, a Rogues style item that just never.
Oh, right.
Got released for some reason, whether it's a pricing thing or utility thing, whatever. But yeah, that happens a lot. And it's just not a lot of fanfare of just like, we're not doing it, because who celebrates not doing something,
sure,
right?
Yeah. Get used to it, Bryce.
Yes. It's the wave of the future is not doing things.
Yeah.
But the Rogue's Tavern, that the day that we spent a day kind of when Brian started doing all the branding stuff, we spent a day. That's when we shot all the product shots. That's when we shot a lot of the B-roll that you see in the behind the scam for the Rogue's Tavern.
Right.
And I really thought that just that whole shooting day was really nice. Like there aren't a lot of opportunities where we're all at the same place working on the same thing outside of scam school shoots, which are pretty stressful because we're all working at like 100% for most of the time. And
like managing people and
you're out in public and yeah.
Like, oh, we have to get all these episodes done. Mm-hmm. And yeah, there's just so much going on.
But, you know, it was a really nice day outside. Brian was having a lot of fun learning the best way to brand those lids. We went through, like, we did a lot of test stuff. We did some tests on, like, cardboard to figure out the pattern. The trick with branding with a really wide brand like that, because it's not like a wired brand that, like, that you think of when like for a cattle brand.
Right. It's just like a big metal plate basically. Yeah.
The issue with that is heat placement. You got to rotate it cuz it's like a butane light or butane grill sort of propane thing. So you have to turn it to keep the heat even so that when you brand it, it doesn't look imbalanced, you know. And so figuring out the right amount of time. And I think probably the really coolest thing about the branding is that the steam that shoots out through the cracks but the gaps in the brand actually make a really cool sort of smoke pattern around the points of the star, because those are where the big gaps are. And it's just a really nice unintentional design or rather look that makes every one of them unique.
Yeah, it's funny. When back when I had my hand in scam stuff, like right before you were hired, I really liked trying to put some kind of individual unique touch in everything, which back then ended up being me just like writing weird random notes on shipping orders and stuff. That didn't make it sense to anybody.
And then, shipping note, carat 12.
Right.
That's not an inside joke, is it?
And also just like we had a lot of stuff that was stamped.
Yeah. Right?
And so like just like pop, 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 pop. This one's got 20 stamps. Love it.
Yeah.
You're the only one.
I like the stamp. I really do like that we stamp stuff. Like I just like the idea, the concept that it's something that we do regularly, because you can really tell that it's been like hand touched and not just like a printed thing that looks like it's been stamped, but you can clearly tell it's like a certain type of ink.
Sure.
Especially
if yours gets screwed up, then you're like, yeah, oh man, like this they really screwed this up.
But they thought it was good enough to go out anyway. It's great. You know, little touches like that, which I think are a real nice thing to add to the experience, and they're easy to pull off. You know, it's cheaper than like buying special cardboard boxes that have a logo on it. You know,
But yeah, I like how the fire branding stuff. There's something organic to like the uniqueness of like those patterns that get created and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with stamps, like you can do some unique stuff and you can change the way it looks a little bit by, you know, how hard you're pressing down, how long it's in, how much ink you have on it, all that kind of stuff. But there's something really visually dynamic about all of the fire branding.
Yeah. And you actually get like it kind of looks like the flame, the star in the logo is like shooting fire because of the way that the steam sort of comes out. But then you get these like really nice wisps around the interior of the bee. Like it looks like it's kind of been designed that way because it looks really nice.
Mm. Yeah.
But it's really organic, which is fantastic.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's really the big product launch. Obviously, we got the Arcana artifacts and the decks in, which is something we didn't have them last time we did an episode. I think we had
announced it. Right,
it just went on pre-sale.
Okay,
and then during the month, they started shipping, and people have started getting them. Which is nice. Like Brian's been retweeting a lot of like the people who are, you know, like, oh, I got number 42 or number. Someone just tweeted that they got number 2, the number 2 coin, which is awesome.
And somebody got like the same number challenge coin as they did the wallet.
Yes. That's... No. Was it the wallet?
Yeah, it was the Rogue's wallet.
Oh, I thought they got the tavern, and the tavern coin number was the same as the artifact coin number. Maybe you're right.
But it might have even been two people who had some crazy coincidence.
Yeah,
who knows?
It could be a double coincidence right now.
Wow.
These are the hot exclusives that we bring you.
What are the odds?
Very, very slim.
Yeah, you think.
Slimmer than would be a coincidence. So we shot an unboxing video for both of the Arcana Artifact and the Rogue's Tavern, which were both a lot of fun. One of those was fraught with peril.
Oh yeah, I saw your stream of editing.
That's right. Oh, I did a live stream while I was editing the unboxing video.
Yeah.
While I was doing mostly what that stream was me cutting the edit down, and then trying to color correct it, and then having to walk away from it.
Which, by the way, it was really nice to not be the one who had to figure that out.
Okay, cool. Because I know that we're going to talk about it in a little bit, but there's definitely footage that you were handling in the warehouse. These were both shot in the warehouse that have some color. We need to get new lights in there.
Yeah, I have a small scale solution, but yes.
Cool. So yeah, for the Rogue's Tavern unboxing, if you watch the video, about a minute or two in, they pull out the 1800s mark deck. And they're trying to see, oh, you know, oh, you can tell this is going to be this one. And then Brian flips it. And he's looking, and in the original version of the 1800s mark deck, it was the mark was in the top left corner. Okay. It was just kind of written out 2D, J, S, whatever. And so he was riffling through, and he goes, oh, I don't think these are marked. I think we somehow have unmarked card. We just have 1800s styled cards. And so legitimately the reaction that you get, that you see, is like, can we pause everything? Really did happen. There was probably about 5 or 10 minutes of like everyone, like the panic settling in of, oh my God, we had already shipped out some, or we had already sent some Rogue's Taverns to the fulfillment center. And all of them have been packed with these cards. And so John calls up, I think Bicycle, no, it's whoever makes that specific brand. And it turns out that we have a new generation of the 1800s mark deck. And so they're on the side, on the left side, rather than the top corner.
Right.
But we didn't know that. And they didn't notice when they were looking for marks, which I think is a testament a little bit to how great, how well those are marked.
Right.
But in that whole kerfuffle, I was trying to do some due diligence. I was turning off lights. Mm-hmm. I turned off we had a main fill light, and then an over
the shoulder battery, conserve heat.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, cause that's a high pressure situation. You get lots of lights in there, you get extra heat, and then you risk escalating things just somehow. So, we come back not very long after, turn on the cameras, and we start again. It's
no problem.
No, it's smooth. It goes sailing. Great. It's about 20 or 30 minutes. They're on point. They're being funny. They're showing everything off. We're getting all the footage in pretty much real time. So we don't need to do a lot of after the fact pickups or remember anything. And then we finish shooting, and about 2 minutes after, Brian goes, oh my God, have I been muted this entire time? And when they had that break early on, Brian does this thing on Scam School shoots where he will mute his mic pack, because on a Scam School shoot, you have someone listening, you know, Roberto or whoever is manning the audio bag will be listening pretty much the whole time, because that's what they kind of do, right?
Yeah.
And so he just has a habit of turning his mic pack off, and he'll just need to be reminded, hey, can you just remember to turn your thing on? We're about to start. And so I hadn't checked the bag because the break was shorter than anybody thought it would be, and so I just hit it and went back, and we started. So there's probably a solid 20-25 minutes where there's no audio channel for Brian's mic. So that's why if you listen to it again, it's a pretty dirty mix, yeah, audio wise compared to some of the stuff that we've done, which was something at the time I realized that we could make it work, and eventually that issue sort of settled itself. I don't want to say that it was good enough because it was on the second channel, but you know, it worked. Mm. And it's workable. It's livable. And it saved us from doing another hour or so of shooting, right, to try to recapture all of that chemistry again. You know, they were doing the flamethrower stuff. Plus, they had opened up boxes and stuff. They'd have to wrap everything back up. But, you know.
Yeah. It just would have been like a logistical mess.
And it would have felt fake.
Yeah.
So people can tell when you fake something that on that big of a scale.
Sure.
But that's not the only issue. The fill light, which I had turned off, I forgot to turn back on. And so there's some serious color issues with the way that the lighting was set up. And when I was doing the editing stream, I was like, I don't know, I was trying to over fix it. And when I got back to it the next morning, I realized I could just do something simpler and not spend 20 hours trying to color correct every single clip. Mm-hmm. And so it ended up, it's like,
it's all black and white now.
Yes. It's only, it's a sepia. It's a very mild sepia over everything. But, it was rough because when we finished shooting, turned off the cameras, I was like, this is good. You know, I did this big shoot on my own. I felt like I had done something, you know, pretty substantial, and then it crumbled. It kept crumbling just the entire time. But it happens.
Yeah. And all things considered, as far as like production disasters go, it's probably pretty tame.
Yeah.
Because you were able to make an episode out of that.
Yeah.
You didn't.
A pretty long video. Yeah.
Yeah. And you didn't like delete footage. You didn't.
No.
You didn't like break a camera or anything.
Yeah.
Like it's.
It could have been worse. Which
could have
I think
been
is,
much worse. But yeah.
Is
yeah.
the definite takeaway.
And now, like going forward, like that just builds character.
Yeah.
Now you're like, grizzled, hardened. I've dealt with all these problems before.
This is me, like, smoking in a dark bar room. Hey, kid.
You got your mic unmuted?
Monitor your audio before you start filming. Once we realized that, we bought a Bluetooth receiver that day, like, immediately after everything happened, so that when there are solo shoots like this, you can monitor remotely.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I was not aware of this.
Yeah.
In classic bizarre briefing tradition.
Yes. If you're new to the show, constantly we are all learning brand new things.
Yeah.
On the show, off the show. It's good. BioCow says, I thought it was great. Thank you, BioCow. I am happy that it came out well and it ended up doing what we were supposed to do. So the other big thing, talking about the unboxing video, is that we launched the second channel.
Yay! Which might be where you're watching this right now.
Possibly. Very possibly. Which is youtube.com/scamstuff.
Yes.
I guess we can talk
about... Are you totally sure on that? Like, there's that weird thing where sometimes it goes over to the...
If you use /user/scamstuff, that takes you to the other Google Plus page that is associated with that email.
Which is just like a Brian Brushwood, like, weird...
No, I think maybe it has its icon, but it definitely does not have anything on it.
Right.
But also, I don't think people are used to typing in youtube.com/user/ the username. Sure. But it does... It actually makes doing, like, annotations and stuff kind of screwy.
Yeah, because it automatically... If you just put in a name, it assumes it's at user.
Right.
That.
Or because we're using youtube.com/scamstuff, if we make an annotation to that page, it can't be a subscribe annotation. So then when they click on it, they can't get a pop-up that says, you sure you want to subscribe? Hmm. You know, it's like an extra step. It's like a weird thing. But the decision to go with that channel was because we'd already been using it for scam stuff. Mm-hmm. The Sonic Nausea stuff was on there. The Arson Watch FAQ was on there. The World's Hottest Candy, the Ghost Pepper Roulette. Stuff had been there. There were already about 400 subscribers on there or so. And we already had that URL. Mm-hmm. And another issue was that that was already partner verified. Because when you start a new channel to get a custom URL, you have to meet certain requirements like subscriber counts. You got to have art and stuff, and that channel already had that, so that's kind of the decision to go with that channel, and it was nice. It was a nice little bit of a coincidence that thing existed, and we had already solved a problem for ourselves.
Although at some point, we got to change this banner. We got to change it.
Okay.
The thing that kills me about that banner.
Mm-hmm.
The focus is right behind his ear and not on his eyes.
Yeah.
And it drives me insane. Like, every time I pull it up,
oh, my God. So it was definitely a thing where I wanted to ape the Scam School.
Right, yeah.
Banner. In fact, I mean, I even kind of copied your little box here thing.
Sure, yeah.
But the footage I had, when you make these YouTube banners, you have to have a huge image.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy, like, the template that they give you.
Yeah. It's this, so like, imagine if you're watching the video, like if you're watching the video, there's a point like here on to the other middle point on this side, right about here. that will always be shown, mm-hmm. but then you still have to
on
fill
every
in.
Platform.
You have to still in fill in this huge margin outside.
Yeah, because they use one image for all platforms.
For mobile, for TV.
Which is insane.
It's crazy. It's ridiculous. And so with that constraint, it was I didn't have a lot of, you know, we shot a lot of these really great promo photos of Brian, but I only had so many on hand, and it was like the night before, and I just wanted to have something on here, and it's working for now, but definitely we can update it with something a little cleaner.
It was definitely way better than what was there before.
Was like, it was a not a Rogue's wallet. It was like,
was it your wallet?
Your old wallet? There's some shiny wallet that just had scam cash cards in it.
Yeah.
Which worked kind of for when it was a scam stuff channel.
Yeah.
But now it's more than that. So.
Yeah.
But so some of the things that we're going to try to have on this channel, and you if you were watching this on this channel, you've probably seen things like outtakes. When we have just even more outtakes than would fit in the end of Scam School episodes, exclusive tricks. You've seen things like the knife trick. Brian explains the constantly viral knife trick.
Yeah,
that he does. The super freeze super cool a beer.
Yes,
which is
something that we've covered before a little bit. So it was in the Scam School book.
The first one.
Yes. And there was just like a little video that had no voiceover or anything. It was just a video on Brian's personal channel that was linked to in that. And then we also covered it in our collaboration with King of Random.
That's
which
right.
I had totally forgotten about when
which
I made the video.
Thing.
Yeah. Yeah, it was like a super big boom for us.
Yeah.
So luckily now we've got nicer cameras, we've got nicer lenses.
And so we thought, let's do it up. Let's get some nicer footage because
update it, explain it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think it really came out well.
Yeah.
You know, Brian, it's nice and short. There's a lot of really, you actually learn a lot of the science behind it, in a really, in a really concise manner.
Yeah.
You know, try not to explain, carbon bonds and fucking, you know, molecules. Like, you don't need to do. Look, it gets really cold.
We're not scientists.
No, this is not science school.
Yeah. Although the second channel, science school.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Bleep bloop. That's it. Science school, bleep bloop.
Science school, bleep bloop. Yep. But yeah, and also it, I posted this in the comments. I'm going to say it again because I think it's really great.
Mm.
If you like the topic of super cooling and you thought that video was cool, go check out the super cooling episode of Radiolab.
Yeah.
It was from like early last year or something. And it's a really good way to like wrap your mind around super cooling.
Would you say that episode is super cool?
It's the coolest.
Oh my God. It's like ultra cool.
Yeah.
Also on that channel, we've had the unboxings of the Arcana the Arcana artifact in the Rogue's Tavern. And I think Brian mentions it in the Behind the Scam, but we're working on a new video feature with Brian, with Jason, potentially other people doing similar things to hacking the system.
Yeah,
the Nat Geo show.
It'll be very similar to hacking the system, but it'll be dumber, in the best possible way. There'll be nobody telling us that's too dumb to do. You can't do that. That's not allowed on TV.
True. Yeah. That's a big thing. Is that because I know the guys had they've talked before about it's National Geographic is.
They have
they have high standards for the science and for the experiments that they do.
Stuff
on
has
their
to be
show.
Factual if you're going to put it on there. You know?
But they have to double source everything. You know,
and also they have to worry about like liability and stuff like that.
Right.
And I mean, we have to worry about that sort of,
but
as long as nobody gets hurt,
there's usually not an issue. Plus, you know, that's a TV show, and so when you do 22 minutes at a time, you have to mix in a lot of things, whereas this, it can be more modular, it can be a little more pointed, and we're not stuck in these restrictions of commercial breaks and you know, dealing with big a bigger production studio or going through a network, you know.
Yeah.
It's in very much Brian fashion. It is us taking the reins, the bull by the reins, by the horns. There's a bull and there's a horse, and then one of them has reins. And they need to be taken.
All right. Yeah, I think that's how that goes.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But there's less overhead, and it's very much the raw punk, let's just do it, Brian.
Yeah.
Attitude.
And it'll be real cool. We shot two episodes so far.
Yes.
And I've edited a lot of the first episode.
Mm-hmm.
And
we're still figuring out the format and stuff.
Yeah, and it'll change a bit. I mean, like any show, you know, Behind the Scam changed a lot over time. Once it figured out what it was, after it was like, technically, Scam School Live was Behind the Scam.
That's right. The thing Brian and Justin were doing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's interview magicians and stuff.
Yeah. For like 2 hours.
Yeah. Long time ago.
Yeah, man. How long ago was that? I'm going to look up how long ago that was, because that feels like I remember that.
Four years ago?
Wow.
5 years ago, I want to say. This is a while back. Also, those were real fun video. Like at some point last year, I went through and cleaned up all of the flagged spam comments on the Scam School channel.
Mm-hmm.
And those Scam School Live videos were real fun to go through, because all of the comments were just like the live chat comments. So it's like, hey, what about this trick? Hey, can you talk about this?
Say my name.
Hi, Brian.
Say hi to me.
Hi.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It looks like 2 years ago, he was doing a question and an answer with Justin, but also 4 years ago, which was another. Okay. So, wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
Very, very. But yeah, Behind This Game has evolved a lot. And we've talked in the past a little bit about how Behind This Game has evolved. We've talked about wanting to talk about that more in the future. Cut that. Take two.
Yep.
But all of those changes were sort of at your fingertips to sort of guide that channel or that show and the channel as a whole. Like a lot of the mm-hmm. things that we do now with Scam School are informed by your own proactiveness in wanting the show to be look a certain way or to act a certain way.
Sure.
And I think all of the changes that you've made are great. You know, things like the Up Next on Scam School, I think is probably for me the biggest change, because I hated writing Up Nexts.
Oh,
they were so difficult. If you couldn't think of one, it was impossible.
Every now and then something would come to me and I'd be like, all right, like that's good, that was easy, quick, just roll through it. But most of the time it's like, okay, can I think just of some kind of pun next, related to something,
right?
And
you don't want to do, you know, Up Next the answer, because like that's the whole point of like doing it differently, because everybody knows that they're gonna see the answer after the break or just next.
And for a long time it kind of was just like Up Next, they figure it out. And there every now and then they would do something like real funny, and I was like, well, I can do something real funny. And then, you know, once you start doing it on a week by week deadline, you're like, oh, I don't have time to think of something funny. This is such a hassle.
Just put in a TV show reference or a movie thing,
right? Yeah,
whatever.
And all things considered, that was one of the most recent, like,
that changes. Was pretty recent.
But yeah, I'm glad we got rid of that.
And it's kind of been replaced by sort of the text scrambly sort of bit, which I do like. I do think that's really nice.
It's a little bit of menial work, the way I'm doing it now, at least.
Yeah. But it ties into like a musical sting.
Yeah.
Rather than the Up Next, which was just kind of like, we're going to keep going until the light fades come in, and then we're... Yeah.
And then all those swooshes. Cha-ching!
And they're all like doubled on top of each other, so they're super loud. You know, but changes like that, font changes, not using that really grungy font.
That was my favorite thing to change. You are loved. Get out of here. Nobody wants that font.
So now the big ones that we use are Roboto and not Nanami. What's the block one? Jeez.
Babus?
No, not Babus. That's the new up next font.
Okay.
The title or the Brian's name and his email. Oh jeez. It looks like
So I know we've got Brandon Printed, which is the remix font.
Mm-hmm.
I use Dual a lot for second channel stuff.
Yeah.
What
do we use Nanami for? Nanami is like...
Nanami, I used that quite a bit on Scam School in the past. Nanami is now used in the CTA.
Okay. Yeah.
For Behind the Scam, we use...
Wiretype. Which is a weird font because the normal version is the sort of typewriter sort of look, mm-hmm. but the italic is the sans serif other font that you see on like the congratulations. Right. It's a weird font that it mixes serif and sans serif.
Yeah.
Like that.
But it's kind of like Courier-esque.
Yeah.
Because I think I used Courier Prime for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I found that I really liked the look of Wiretype, so I switched over to that.
But
font talk.
Yeah. But I really I love Roboto, and I want to use it everywhere.
It's a really great Helvetica replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's free.
Yeah. That's a Google font, right?
Maybe.
I think it's a Google font. It is, because that's why they made it for Android.
Oh,
yeah, neat. It was an Android font.
I use bold condensed all the time.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I don't use the condensed very much. I normally use the normal, regular.
Gotcha.
But I do love mixing up the thick. It's got all the thicknesses. It's a really great font family.
Well, it's got a lot of thicknesses. Not all of them,
but I mean a good amount, you know.
Yeah.
It's got heavy and black and bold and regular and thin.
Anyone you need. One of the craziest things for me was like going out and buying fonts and like starting to dawn upon me just how many like weights of fonts there are.
Yeah.
There are like 20 or 30 weights.
Yeah, man.
And it's insane.
Yeah.
Choplin.
Choplin, that's it.
You're thinking of Choplin.
That's the block sort of font that is for Brian's name at the start of the show. It's the old up next font, and it's his email when we do the page lower third.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which is one of the last sort of main staples from old Scam School.
Yeah. Save like the actual theme song.
Mm-hmm.
There really isn't much else that's still left.
I heard some earlier revisions of the theme song.
Really?
It's weird. You're like, oh yeah, I can kind of hear what they were going for.
That would be interesting to go through one day and listen to the different versions of the theme songs. I always get weirded out when I end up listening to the full Behind the Scam, like the whole Behind the Scam theme song is in the project file. So, but the bit that we use now is like literally the last four like chords.
Dun, 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 dun.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the whole thing is like so if you go like and watch the old episodes, that intro is so long.
It's really long.
I remember I was working on that in a hotel on the East Coast because we were like I was traveling with Brian. Yeah. So it was like before a show and we were sitting there and we were trying to find a song to use. And the thing I didn't know is Brian has like a history with that song.
Really?
And I forget how, but he's used like elements of that before, or maybe like, I think part of that song was used in another thing. Mm-hmm. And so
he's just like, I have this thing and we can use it still, right?
Yeah. Well, and so much of all that stuff, like how it started was like, oh, we kind of already have these sort of assets. Like the old Behind the Scam intro had like this weird like magnifying glass theme.
Yeah, because it was like a chalkboard. where yeah. Behind This Game was written in like that curvy sort of font in a chalk style.
Yeah.
And then you would zoom into the magnifying glass.
Yeah. And so that I think that was made for when Scam School Live was Behind This Game.
Mm-mm.
And it just kind of didn't really get used. And so Brian was like, we already have these assets and it has Behind This Game. Like, yeah. Let's just use that. So use that. And also like...
Very pragmatic. A lot yeah. of pragmatic decisions were yeah. made.
And there was a lower third that was like, graph paper and mm-hmm. a magnifying glass.
Yeah,
like,
and it was that animated, I think?
I don't think so.
Okay. I have seen that.
In fact, no, because I think somebody might have animated it, but never gave us the files. So I had to like hand animate it. Yeah. And also the Scam School lower third animation is like broken. So I had to go and fix that stuff.
Yeah.
Because like the second the animation starts, you see like a black silhouette of it.
Yeah, there's a black fringe. Up. Oh, the silhouette. Yeah.
And then it goes up into place of it, and like you see it in the first like 150, 200 episodes of Scam School
because
they just didn't fix it.
Yeah.
And I remember
that
being insane.
That was the most annoying thing to edit out when I started because I wouldn't. It wasn't in the template, and I hadn't put it in the template to crop out that black frame. And so I just remember because using the masking tools on Premiere kind of suck sometimes.
Yeah.
So animating those was always a big hassle.
I mean, luckily with that one, it's mostly even enough, and it's fast enough that you can just kind of, you know,
do a straight
yeah. line up and down, and just sort of keyframe that.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was a kind of a mess.
So yeah, so the second channel we have, we were talking before the show a design philosophy, or yeah. You know, ideas for how things will progress visually, which is great. I mean, all of this is to say that I think you have probably one of the, maybe the best of the whole crew to be taking a proactive lead on that.
Hmm. Yeah. You know, that's like, it's the most fun part of any of these projects. Mm-hmm. When we started doing Scam School Remix, the most fun part for me was like, okay, I have the footage and we're going to release next week. I have to figure out how to style this. Mm. And then like creating assets and creating like a theme sort of, and it was really fun to like redesign Behind This Game because when we started that it was all reappropriation of stuff, and then at a certain point I was like, this is ridiculous, like it needs a voice,
and so you gave it a total overhaul.
Yeah, and so it ended up going in like a I push it sort of in a more like spy redacted document kind of style.
Yeah. Sort of like encryption, like you have the pixelation stuff going on, the interference things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so that was fun. And like the second channel stuff, there's, you know, I think it'll be a little while we kind of ramp up production a little bit and kind of figure out like, okay, we have these tracks of this kind of video that we do frequently, mm-hmm. and this kind of video that we do frequently.
So they should have this sort of tone and language, and then these other things can be more looser or more tighter. Yeah,
mm-hmm. But just kind of as a general broad scope kind of thing, I really like sort of pushing against a lot of the things that bother me about all of our Scam School content, where it's like, you know, with Scam School, we have this intro stand-up, which is just like telling you what you're about to watch, which is unnecessary. That's something that people understand from, ideally from the title, if we have a good title,
mm-hmm.
Which is something that's changed over time.
Or otherwise can be explained in one sentence before the thing.
Yeah, or in the description or whatever. And, you know, we actually have two intros in Scam School. We have the super tease and then we have the intro.
Right.
Both of them saying the same thing in different ways.
Yeah.
Or
if they're not, the super tease is not saying anything.
Fluff. Yeah.
Right.
And you know, we have a lot of things like that. Some are big, some are really small, but
Because Game School started off very formally, almost like a sometimes as long as a TV show. And so it was...
And it was meant to be like a TV show, you know? Mm-hmm. Brian started this Game School because he wanted to do TV, but you can't do TV if you've never done TV before. Mm-hmm. So he was like, well, I can figure this out.
But as a result, some of the...
There are a lot of trappings of that medium. And so with second channel stuff, I really want to, you know, it's... I like that second channel stuff is going to have the capability to have pacing, which I feel like Scam School doesn't. Scam School is breakneck pacing. It's just nonstop. Like, when I edit Scam School, basically nobody is allowed to take a breath, right? If somebody's taking too long of a breath, I will cut it out and do a camera change.
Yeah.
Right? Just to, you know, have the smallest time length on the video.
And a part of that is because the way that they're shot still has those old trappings of doing all of these beats. Mm-hmm. Whereas if they're doing less of those beats, then everything can breathe a little bit in about the same amount of time.
Right. And so I like that the new stuff can have a little bit of pacing. I like that the new stuff, if something feels unnecessary, we don't have to do it. Mm-hmm. Right. And sometimes Scam School, it's hard to do that because even though, you know, we have a lot of creative control, it's got so much momentum in the way that it already is. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't dramatically change it. You can kind of dramatically change it over a long period of time, like I kind of have with the style of it. But, you know, it's hard to say, like, oh, this is just a super weird episode because we don't have this whole half of the episode that we usually would. Mm-hmm. So, you know, with second channel stuff, like if let's say we're teaching a trick or something, if it doesn't make sense to have the other person, like, then perform the trick and Brian would go like, oh, wow, you performed it so well, like sometimes we do on Scam School. Mm. Then
we just not do it.
We just don't do it. Yeah. And it'll be a way quicker video then. And it'll feel like every bit of it matters. Every bit of it is significant and important.
And it also can feel a little more raw.
Yeah.
Like with the unboxing video, like for the Arcana artifact, you can see me in a lot of that. Mm-hmm. Because of the way we shot it. But, when we shot it that way, that meant we could get a lot of live over-the-shoulder pickups.
Sure.
Instead of, you know, doing them after the fact and dealing with continuity things. And it's an unboxing. So people legitimately want to see stuff being opened.
Right.
And if you sort of recreate that, then it's a weird thing. But I know Brian has talked a lot about you and I or whoever else outside of Brian having... being able to have a on-screen role as, you know, as called for, on the second channel, because it's not just about Brian, you know?
Right. Yeah.
But so it being that raw makes it a good fit for the second channel compared to if it was for the Scam School channel, it would probably have looked a little different.
Yeah, and it would feel out of place over there, and yeah, there's, you know, since it's so new and like we're still figuring stuff out, like it's really easy to incorporate so much stuff that's changed over time, like having us here doing the stuff that we do, mm-hmm. And yeah, it's a really interesting starting place to grow and adapt and change.
Yeah. Let's see, what else have we got? So we are recording this on the Monday after Thanksgiving. We kind of hinted on the last episode about holiday stuff, but did you do anything? Did you go see your family for Thanksgiving? No.
Nah. Nah, you know, I had a bunch of people who were like, you should come hang out. Like, there was Travis's thing.
That was fun.
Yeah, Mike TV invited me to a thing.
Oh, fun.
My mom invited me to a thing. My dad invited me to a thing.
Your shit's blowing up.
I guess. And you know what I did?
None of them.
I sat at home.
Did you play Rocket League?
Not much. I mean, a little bit, of course.
I imagine that all of your downtime is always Rocket League or watching Whiplash.
It's not far off. It really isn't.
No, but I was the same way on Thursday. On Thanksgiving Day, I was pretty much working, getting that Black Friday challenge behind the scam.
Right, yeah.
Redone. Because
with all the extra B-roll and
replacing all the B-roll, because we had used images on the vessel version.
Gotcha.
And then when we were looking at it, Brian was like, what if they were the videos? So it was like resourcing video for all of that stuff, mm-hmm. trying to find video for stuff that's never had video.
Right.
All while trying to do it the day before it needs to go up. And also it's Thanksgiving Day, so I'm not going to bust into here and try to sneak footage or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, but then, yeah, I went to Travis's thing on Saturday, which was fun. He streamed a lot of it. He streamed like the cooking of it. And then after we ate, he streamed us playing card games.
Yeah.
You got to hear my awesome regular show voices.
Yeah. I caught a little bit of that.
They're good. I won't do them now because I'm so confident they were good. Right. That I don't need to prove to anybody.
Sure.
That I do.
You're already satisfied.
I'm good.
You don't need the validation.
Right. We definitely went through 2 bottles of Ruinum.
Hard stuff.
Yeah. I won't tell the whole story, but Travis almost died taking a sip of it. So if that tells you anything about how potent the mystical Ruinum wine is.
Yeah, I've had about a sip of it.
That's enough. That's enough to understand how evil it gets.
So. Yeah. But yeah, I just kind of worked through that. Mm-mm. I guess that's how I do most things. Christmas, I'll probably actually head out though.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, I can justify a certain amount of staying at home and not doing anything and not seeing anybody, but at some point, you just
got to
go.
You got it, yeah. It was the same thing. Like, I probably could have figured out a way to go home for Thanksgiving, but I just booked tickets to go home for Christmas. So, that's one less thing I would have need to have, like, gotten all these videos and stuff prepared for me to take time off. And with December and Christmas stuff, it'll be a little easier to get 10 days of stuff set up than if it was like last month.
Also, I just don't really like Thanksgiving that much.
We've talked about this because you don't like eating. It's my
least favorite.
You and food, you have a very long history with food. Is it?
Yeah, I'm really weird with food, but also I just don't like most of Thanksgiving food.
Yeah, because it's like turkey.
Yeah, like the only turkey I've ever liked has been at Rudy's. Mm-hmm. And other than that, I've never had turkey that I've liked.
Okay, so I'm gonna name you a Thanksgiving food.
Okay.
Rating of 1 to 5.
Corn is good. Corn is Thanksgiving, okay. Right?
Yes.
All right. So yeah, I like that.
Corn, 1 to 5, 5 being the highest.
4.
Okay. Turkey.
Depending on how it's prepared. Turkey, 2.5.
Ham.
2.
Mmm.
Maybe 1.5.
Yams, sweet yams.
1.
Wow. Cranberry sauce or what have you.
1 or 2.
Wow. Mashed potatoes.
Let's go 3.5.
Okay.
I can eat mashed potatoes. I'm not like a mashed potato fiend, but I'm fine with mashed potatoes.
Yeah. Stuffing.
Let's go 1.5.
So it's really it just statistically, Thanksgiving is not your jam.
Right. I'm running like a 2-star average on if Thanksgiving that. Food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of the same way about some of the stuff, you know, cranberries, meh, beans, whatever.
Beans are all right, but yeah.
Turkey can get dry really easily.
Yeah.
But then Christmas, you know, Christmas has got all these other things going on, and I'm actually going to be home through New Year's, so that's part of it. So that's our holiday plans.
Bam. Holiday update. Blow.
Jingle, jingle.
John's probably going to go see family.
Probably, right? Because by that
time... Does he have local family? I know he definitely has some family out in, like,
I think his wife Kelsey does.
Okay.
Because they got married in town.
Right.
And then they went home for the reception or something.
And John was living in Florida.
Yep.
For a bit. And I think his family is, like, mid-east area. Like, or maybe they're in, like, Pennsylvania or something?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's the John update. Yeah. Your John date for the month.
Your definitive, authoritative John source for all John news.
This is where we're going to cut in John saying, "Thanks, guys." That'll be the that'll
spot
be the,
on. Spot on. You nailed it.
Okay. So if you have been watching Brian's podcast, Brian does a lot of podcasts. If you only know him from Scam School, which I think a lot of people do.
Yeah.
You may not know that he does a lot of podcasts.
1.3 million people.
Almost 1.4.
Ooh.
And he's
I was looking at Marquez. He's pushing like 3.5 million.
Wow. For the record, this is Marquez Brownlee. MKBHD tech 7-foot titan.
Yeah.
Both figures.
He's great. And his numbers are fucking through the roof. And he just started doing giveaways.
Oh shit! So it's gonna go. It's gonna hit five.
If you thought we were even like halfway Marquez numbers,
no.
Goodbye. Goodbye to that dream.
We can't all have Deadmau5 do our intro music. You know?
Yeah, I mean, like, jeez. Let's just BFF. So
getting free Teslas and shit. We don't. It's not us.
Brian would love it if he got a free Tesla. If he was just
are you kidding me?
Let's do a Tesla review on this fucking channel.
And so he does a lot of podcasts. He does Cord Killers, which is about
Brian does, to be clear. We're Brian back on does, Brian.
Not Marquez Brownlee. Marquez Brownlee does no podcasts. I'm saying it right now. no, Brian does he does Cord Killers, which is about cord cutting, things like Netflix and Hulu and ways to watch TV without cable. Mm-hmm. He does Night Attack, which is a weekly comedy show going on 7 or 8 years, even longer. In one form or another, he's been doing the stuff with Justin for a very long time.
Sure.
He also does Weird Things, which is a science meets fiction, supernatural sort of show on Sundays. And if you've been watching the live stuff or watching the video, you'll notice I'm trying to put a sheen on all of the live stuff. I handle the live switching on basically all of those shows now. Mm-hmm. And, you know... A part of it is to give Brian one less thing to worry about while he's also trying to be on the show.
Right.
And so as I've sort of taken domain of like switching stuff, I'm trying to update all of these shows visually to sort of match one another to, you know, have sort of similar to actually it's very similar to the way that Bizarre Briefing's video is set up. Where it's not always like normally when it's three of us, it's set up like this so that we don't need to fill the whole screen. We can have a little bit of background texture.
Right.
We have the bug, we have the chat, and no more 3D effect.
Yay!
3D effect is gone.
Yeah. Stop skewing that chat.
Right.
No more skew.
That's what bugged me the most is that the chat was always, the chat was like 3D tilted backwards so that it, because there's not a way to stretch it smaller. So they've always 3D tilted it back and just like never taken it back. So very gradually I've been like pulling back on that.
And I'm a big fan of like a clean, like geometric look. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and especially with the podcast stuff, because there are these other graphical elements, we don't need to establish this language of like, oh, the guys are looking at each other. They need to visually be, their frames need to be looking at each other.
Yeah.
You know, that stuff is, it's not as necessary as I guess it could have been before. Or, you know, it feels, to me, it actually feels a little less podcasty doing it this way, which I think is a good, I think, podcast has its own word, but I think these live shows, they're shows essentially. They are just shows. They don't need to fit into the podcast word.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So things like adding backgrounds, adding color, having the bugs up more often and just, you know, make it feel intentional. That was something that Justin said, remarked on with the Night Attack stuff, is make it feel intentional and like... it is a higher, a more produced show, honestly, you know, that it is not like with Night Attack used to just have this frame that would sit over Justin and Brian's image, like videos. But if you try to switch to a one shot or something, there was no that one frame is just one image file. It's not like elements. So that frame either needs to disappear or needs to slide away or something.
Yeah.
And it's not the right way you should do that. So
and also there are like a billion diamonds on screen when you use that frame.
Yes.
Which was a little overkill.
It is a little much. So I think the only really diamonds that I use now are in the bug, and the DCTV bug, obviously. And then the lower third is flanked by diamonds.
Okay.
But, you know, I was considering there's a dot pattern for the background. I was considering instead of a dot, doing a diamond, like a little pixel sized diamond, but that felt like too much.
Yeah,
that's what felt like too much. I'm excited. I'm excited to make the live shows better because I think that is something that doesn't take a lot of effort and we can do it and just keep things fresh. You know, and earn my keep.
Yeah, the brief period of time of like a month or two when I was switching Night Attack last summer. Yeah. I was really excited to introduce some new elements because I felt like it had, even though then Night Attack was kind of new, I felt like it had kind of,
it was a product of the NSFW show.
Yeah. And also it was like a drink and all of those particles had rested at the bottom and it was just kind of sitting there.
And you needed to stir it up.
You got to stir it up a little bit.
Available now at scamstuff.com. Yep.
Nailed it. And so I was really excited to do the, you know, like the split screens and the boxes and the billion different shots. And
yeah.
One of my favorite moments was at some point in the middle of an episode, they created a character. So on my laptop, I was creating a lower third that was like a special lower third for that character. And then I introduced it in the middle of the show. And doing, you know, fun stuff like that. And I'm glad to hear that there's some polish going into that these days.
Yeah. Doing things like video pips so that you can actually see the guys react because they're doing a lot of the dance on stuff now.
Right.
So being able to get them live reacting to stuff or even just because there have been bits where they try to show a guest a video. Mm-hmm. But because the way the Skype is set up, the video has to be on screen and they've never had a pip shot before. So there's no way to get the guest's face reaction while they're watching
with the
something.
Source. Yeah.
Right. So things like that. And another thing I do want to do is a similar sort of split screen with whatever media is on this computer and then a face, you know, stuff like that.
Gotcha.
Because part of that show is the immediacy of like showing people things and people bringing things in and being able to enable that more often. Is going to be a good thing. So, we did it first. All of these visual upgrades are sort of based on what you see and have seen on the Bizarre Briefing for the past couple months.
Exclusive.
Wow. Oh, man. So you have built a new computer.
I did.
We were talking about this a while ago, briefly.
I think last episode I'd ordered the parts. And
no, you hadn't ordered them. You were on the fence about deciding.
Yeah, I was like a couple of days away from ordering or like a week away. But now it's built.
So very briefly.
Yep.
Bullet points. What are the specs?
So we got
i7?
i7. 5280K.
Okay.
6-core.
6-core.
We have 32 gigs of DDR4 RAM.
Fucking crazy. That's great. A lot of... I mean, it's great.
It's great.
It's
great.
It's perfect.
It's great. We have a little bit less than 500 gig solid state. We have 2 terabyte hard drive. Mm. We have
970.
GTX 970. We have.
Did you get the water cooling? That was my thing when we talked about it last. Is water cooling scares me.
Yeah, I did not go water cooling.
Okay.
I got a third party cooler, the Noctuna. not to a
something.
Something.
Yeah.
It looks really impressive.
Oh, cool. Is it like a big fan?
It looks like a Motorhead, like engine block, like from the front of a car. It's crazy. It's like this big, metal thing, and it's got a fan running through it. It's crazy. It's awesome. It's huge. Uh-huh. It's insane. Yeah, and then it's all put in a Corsair Vengeance case.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very cool. And
there's a motherboard in there somewhere.
Yeah. Someone.
It's a nice motherboard.
Yeah. I did not realize that on your previous machine that you were doing your renders were taking 2 hours for something like a scam school.
Yeah.
Whereas now I'm sure they're running a little closer to real time.
Yeah. Now scam school edits are about 4 minutes, 50 seconds. For an encoding.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
So vast improvements.
Fair.
Yeah, because with the laptop, there was, you know, it ran kind of slow. It was really great when I got it. Because before then I was running on an even older laptop. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it was great, but Scam School, especially once we switched over to 4K, like really slowed things down and all of that kind of stuff. And then there at some point, like Adobe products had this weird issue where it would start rendering and then it would stall out. And you'd have to do mission control to like refresh some kind of cache or something, and then it would start rendering again. And there were literally times where sometimes I would say, oh, this is going to take a while. I'll let it render overnight. And then I'd wake up and it had just stopped at like 20% and never picked back up.
Mm-hmm.
So that was an issue. And, you know, sometimes it would be like right up against the deadline and I would be like, okay, I'm going to hit render. I'm going to run out the door and grab food because I haven't eaten today because I've been working all day since I woke up.
Right.
And then I'm going to come back and hopefully it hasn't stalled out.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it'll be finished, but probably not.
But at least I've got something done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's really not a lot I can do other than just do this on my trackpad for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
And so now I don't have that problem. And it renders pretty fast.
Nice.
When I render in 4K, it's a bit slower, but even then, it's like way faster than it would be on here.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. I'm glad to hear that though.
It's so much better.
Are you keeping your footage on your SSD? Or
I keep footage on my SSD for projects that I'm working on, and then I push it over to my hard drive once I've finished with it.
I was just using my SSD for like cache stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Not even as a scratch disk, but I just got a new SSD that I'm planning on using it similar to keeping active footage on that.
Gotcha.
And I'm really excited because I can tell that some things have been a little faster. Mm. Just having another separate disk for scratch disk and media cache and all the craziness.
Yeah, and this laptop has a 500 gig SSD, so I'm already used to like dealing with file management on that kind of space.
Yeah,
And now I have like this whole big cold storage thing, so it makes it a lot easier.
Awesome, Rocket League working real great on it.
Oh, it's so smooth. It opens up so much faster. Like on my old computer, I would like double click Rocket League and then wait for like 5 minutes for it to come
on.
It was insane.
That's
wow. And now it's just like boop, 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 and it runs super smooth. Yeah. It's real great.
Awesome, man. I'm excited. I'm really excited. The new computer feeling lasts for a little while. So you're gonna.
It's pretty good. It's really quiet.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm sure it'll get louder in time, but like right now, it's really.
Did you get like gaskets and stuff and like?
No. But it's so quiet.
Yeah, man. One thing I like about my new computer is that it's way, way faster for me to do streaming stuff, that looks good. Since the last month, I've been trying to stream every day,
mm-hmm.
On Twitch and on diamondclub.tv.
Right.
Whether it's, you know, games or doing music or editing like the unboxing video
Twitch.com/Neshcom.
Twitch.com/Brightcast.
Brightcast?
/Brightcast, yeah. Unfortunately, because Neshcom was my Justin.tv. Yeah. And I've been having a good time with it, just trying to do like an hour a day or so. But I worry, and maybe you can give me feedback on it. Totally erratic time. Like sometimes it's in the morning, like before DTNS. I consider anything before 3:30, aka DTNS time, morning. Sometimes it is, you know, 11, 12, 1 a.m., 1 o'clock in the morning, after everything has happened. And it's been very like when I get the time to do it, which is not great, because on Twitch, you know, and not only are they doing 6, 7, 8 hours every day, they're always doing it at the same times, but it's like impossible for me to do that because we don't have, you know, set work hours or right. Like with the podcasts and stuff that happen at all different times of the week. I don't want to put you on the spot, because I'm sure you haven't watched. I don't assume that you've watched much of any of them. But is an erratic time schedule less appealing to you as a viewer? Like, is that something where like, man, I don't even know when it's gonna be on, and I'm getting the email at all fucking times of the day, and just.
For me, it really depends on the person and the content. So with somebody like I watch Low Five on Twitch, and he's a guy who plays Rocket League professionally, and he's in College Station, which is just like an hour and a half, 2 hours from here.
Yeah, it's very close.
And so I watch him a lot, but he streams in my work hours, which is, you know, 8 p.m. to 6 a.m.
Yeah.
And I don't watch them every day, but I like to know that if I'm in that kind of time frame and I happen to be like in the mood to watch his stuff, mm-hmm. I can just turn on Twitch and he's probably streaming. Mm-mm. But then if you go to somebody like Patrick Klepek, I really like watching, you know, his Mario Maker mornings and stuff like that. Mm. But I'm never awake for that stuff.
Right.
He does it reliably at the same time, but I just catch.
I've never watched him live. I always watch him on YouTube. Yeah, which is sort of how why I've been aping, just trying to do an hour or so, because mm-hmm. it then
those are way more digestible
on for YouTube. People. Yeah, even something that's like 2 or 3 hours or so is like not terrible. I mean, it's a lot to ask, but but it's, again, it's not at a set time. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's interesting to know that like you are very hyper aware of when, not hyper aware, but you're aware of when streamers have very set times.
Yeah, and you
like Curly's always on at like 8 o'clock.
Curly has a pretty set time, but you know, for him, it's another one of those things where it's like, if I'm in the mood to watch something, I will pull up Twitch or whatever, and I will see who's online. Mm. But it's not very often that I go, oh, it's 8 o'clock, gonna go pull up this stream, because I know it's starting right now.
Yeah.
And so it is kind of nice to know that something goes on at roughly a regular time, just so that way I don't have to like think about it too hard. Like,
yeah. Okay.
But if it's something really worth watching, I think if it gets archived, then that is more valuable to me than that it is at a regular time.
I see. That's good to know, because I am trying to archive as much of it as I can. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to be very specific about what music I use and what things I play. Like, I just got Smash, and I feel weird about playing Nintendo stuff because it's weird to archive that stuff now.
Right.
Though I don't intend to monetize it, but then, you know, Nintendo has that whole monetization program, and it's sure. It's a weird thing. But yeah, okay, so that's something I'll keep in mind, because I want to be streaming more. I think I said it a lot, but I think streaming will only grow and get legs, and we will see new societal memes, not like meme-based memes, like Metal Gear Rising memes. The memes. You haven't played Metal Gear Rising. God. Memes are a big part of that. Okay. Societal memes. Well, they were in... Anyway.
Cultural memes. The meme as it is defined in the dictionary. Yes.
Right. I think more of those will grow out of streaming as that sector grows into whatever size it ends up being. Hmm. And so I'd like to get in early and try to figure out best practices for me and for my schedule and you know, find people on there. But just with the time being an issue, the chats being an issue for a while, it was like, well, which chat should I use? Right. Because we have DiamondClub.tv has a 24-hour chat going on all the time.
And proprietary IRC or use Twitch chat.
Right. Yeah. It's a weird thing because it's either like, well, Twitch people, there are random people who just kind of show up, and then if you ignore them, then they will not even want to watch anymore.
Right.
Because they'll feel ignored. But then, you know, the DCTV people are the most regular or reliable people who would watch in the first place. But then if you make concessions for them, then it's like you're kind of screwing new people potentially out, or you're making the barrier to entry higher.
Yeah.
So it's stuff that I'm kind of trying to figure out. Mm-hmm. Because I see, I really like the way Curly does it, where it's, and I think Curly probably does it the best, where it's a set schedule pretty much at a set time. He archives everything. He's got Twitch chat. He looks at the DCTV stuff off screen. Mm-hmm. It's just trying to ramp myself up into that, mm-hmm. because being on for that long is not a sustainable thing.
It's tough.
It's, yeah. That's what I'm... I am aiming for.
Yeah, it's an interesting space. I stream sometimes. I would like one of these days I'm going to stream out of that new computer.
You haven't yet? I thought you had streamed since you built it too.
Nope. Oh, I just haven't had time, you know.
Mm, yeah. Cuz I usually like your stream layouts. Yeah. And I like the your intro graphic of like your apartment. Right. Because I like to imagine that shot, it's like from the back of your computer, your monitors, right? Mm-hmm. And so you see all the film posters. I like to imagine that's the only corner of your apartment that is furnished.
Yeah. Because I took that photo before I have a couch.
Right.
And now I have a couch.
Oh, you got the couch.
I did get a couch.
Is it a good couch?
It's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's an IKEA couch.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. And it's in pretty good shape.
Yeah.
So, from what I could tell.
Mm-mm. You got it used from someone in your apartment.
From some lady a couple buildings over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm surprised she still held on to it because you were talking about that a while ago.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, she seemed pretty pumped to get rid of it. It was pretty cheap.
Woo! Get rid of
Yeah.
Take my couch.
That couch is going to die in that apartment. I'm not moving that couch anymore. Going up three flights of stairs, that's a real pain.
Yeah, man. But now you have a couch.
Now it looks like a place where somebody lives in my apartment.
Instead of like a 24 before style.
It was,
like,
before it was like, did somebody die in here and they just left all their stuff in this apartment?
Are
like,
they in the middle of moving out?
Yeah, what's going on? But now it's like, oh, there's a couch. People can actually sit down if they come in here.
So now you're living that couch life. You own a couch.
Yeah.
It's kind of nice, right?
I mean, it's fine. I've set stuff on it.
Have you sat on it?
Like once.
What?
Yeah. It's in the middle of the living room. I don't have anything in the living room.
Oh, because you don't have a big, you don't have a TV.
I don't have a TV. Who has a TV these days?
I'm a grandpa over here, I guess.
I've got a computer. I've got a computer with big old monitors. And I watch everything on my computer. I got a good sound system on my computer. I got good visual. I got a new computer. It runs everything so smooth. Why would I have a TV?
Sure.
That's insane.
I don't know. Sometimes you like a big screen experience.
I was thinking about moving my couch just right in front of my big glass doors out to my balcony. Mm-hmm. And I could just sit there and like look across at people in the other apartments. Be like, what's up? I got a couch now, man.
Watching you, bro. You watching TV? That's cool. I'm going to watch you.
This is the only entertainment in my apartment that isn't my computer. People watching.
Set it up like Brian's office where you like have it behind your computer.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So you can, because I think the problem with the sitting at watching stuff on the computer too long is my chair is not great for like long-term sitting and watching stuff.
All right.
Which is why I watch a lot of stuff on TV. But if there was a solution that mixed the two.
Whoa.
Holy
talking big
crap.
I was really happy to get it. So I've got monitor mounts that like are articulating.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really sold on the idea because I knew that once I got a couch, if I really wanted to, or like a chair or something, if I really wanted to, I could have that in the living room and then just like flip the monitor backwards.
Okay.
And then just watch it from the chair.
Sure.
So
how big are those monitors? Those aren't
27, 29.
Okay. That's a pretty decent size if it's close enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like I use it to watch stuff while I'm in the kitchen and whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. Very cool. Couch date.
Couching it up.
I think that's just about, I think that's everything. We had some things that we were going to, we can save for next time to talk about with John or Brian.
Yeah.
But I think that'll do it for the Bizarre Briefing. Unless you have any last words.
I think that's pretty much it. We don't have like any extra video stuff or anything.
Mm-mm.
I mean, we just got regular old episodes and stuff.
I do want to give you a shout out for your ad, the 00.com ad.
Yeah.
That was great. I loved the lamp on your trash can.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't tell if you had done that so you could get a lamp in the shot or if that's where you keep your lamp.
I did that to get my lamp in the shot.
Okay.
And it was a thing where I took my trash out my door because we have valet trash service mandatory stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, I need to put my trash out. And then I think it was, yeah. And then, so they took the trash out and then I pulled it back in and it was like right next to the couch because the doors were like right next to the couch. And I was like, oh, that would be a really good way to get it in the shot. And that's such a super dumb it's furnishing.
Like if you look at it, if you don't look very long, you can't tell.
It almost looks normal.
I think my old apartment had that exact same valet trash, trash can. So it definitely stuck out for me.
That's funny.
Oh, and then you can see the sticker. When it zooms out, you can start to see the sticker. That's great. And then the don't trust people with a C in their name line was very funny.
Yeah, because in the so I made this not long after seeing the latest James Bond film, Spectre.
Oh, yeah.
And then we did a Spectre episode of Cinematography, my other podcast about movies.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was on the mind, and then, it just... There's a character in the movie named C.
Oh.
And so I thought it'd be really funny if, like, C's in here, and then Brian's
you
always
can't
like...
trust them.
Brian's always like, Schwood, there's no C in Schwood.
Right.
And so I thought that'd be a real funny take.
That's really clever. It's a longer ad, but it is. It tells a nice little story.
There's also like a ton of backstory that I cut out.
So, there's actually a director's cut that's 5 minutes long.
Well, so I took an article from The Guardian, and I went in and like edited the text on the page and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so like. It's horrible because it's an article about a real tragedy that happened internationally. So it's just this photo of like a building that's on fire. And I changed all the text and the headlines and everything. And it's talking about like a Chalupa incident and how 007 was out there. And there was like some mysterious Chalupa incident.
Chalupa.
And MI6 had to dismantle the 007 or the 00 sector. And so that's why like he doesn't have a job anymore. He had that really nice apartment in Spectre, right. Not anymore. Now he's got this run down apartment with nothing in it. And it was there was a really good gag on it where after I pour in the orange juice.
Mm.
I go over by my laptop and I'm looking at this article and I'm trying to do like voice commands to my computer and I'm like, computer shut down and it won't do anything. So I just like very slowly fold down my laptop as it's got this Chalupa incident like headline on it.
Yeah.
I thought it was really funny, but it just really messed with the pacing, and it was already such a long episode.
Yeah.
Or long ad.
Oh, man. But really another top-notch domain.com ad.
Thanks.
Wink.
We also did that War Games ad, which I had been meaning to do for like 2 years and just never got around to it. And then I was like, I could probably put this together real
kind of quickly.
Scrappy, yeah.
That was how the how its domain ad was kind of made. Mm-hmm. It was just like, I can do this in my apartment. I can do the voiceover. Right. I can get it done today and it'll be good. Yeah. Great stuff.
Yeah.
Check out ads. Buy things. Consumerism. Get it.
All the kids are talking about it.
So I think that's going to do it for the Bizarre Briefing. Where would you like to send people, Brandt? If you if someone was like, hey, give me the hot lowdown on Brandt.
All right, if you want the latest in the lowdowns on Brandt, check me out on Twitter. That's Gatowag, GATOWAG.
Yeah.
Or you can just like leave comments here, and I'll see that. If you want a little bit of interaction.
Oh man.
Whoa.
Oh my God. And you can find me on Twitter at Brycas, BRYCAS. And yeah, you will see us comment on like Scam School and stuff.
Yeah.
Probably as ourselves.
Yeah.
You know. But that's going to do it. If you like this show and would like to see some of the previous episodes, you can go to neshcom.com/TBB. That's neshcom.com/TBB. That'll take you to the site where you can get the RSS feed if you want to put it into your iTunes and get the audio. The videos are on youtube.com/BBpediaVideos. That's BBpediaVideos. Got it. I figured it out. And there's a playlist there to watch the old episodes. I guess we'll see you then.
See you
next time.
Yeah.
On the Bizarre Briefing.
Yep. Yeah. Bye.
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 Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.